In this video, I'm going to be going over some of the best preference settings inside After Effects you want to make sure you enable when you're working inside the software. I've done some research and it's been a few years since a preferences video on YouTube really came out, and there have been quite a few updates in the last few years of After Effects that have been added to preferences. So I wanted to make sure that I go over it. That way you guys have the latest information. So without further ado, let's dive into After Effects and open up the preferences. So to open up your preferences, just go up to After Effects, Preferences, General. Once Preferences is open, we'll start in the General tab. The first thing you want to make sure that's marked is Default Spatial Interpolation to Linear. If you guys ever worked with animations before, and if you ever had to right-click, go to Keyframe Interpolation, and change the Spatial Interpolation to Linear, this will actually automatically do that for you. The second thing on this list, which is actually a new feature in 2023, is that you now have the default option to separate the position properties as separated values. So I always check this box. That way, for example, if you ever animate shapes or different layers, the X and Y will automatically be divided for you, saving a step to have to actually, you know, click P, right click and go to separate dimensions. It'll already be separated. Now, some other personal preference ones. If you don't like the chime After Effects makes at the end of rendering out of video, you can uncheck that. This really depends if you like it or not. Another thing you might want to consider is uncheck the box next to Enable Home Screen. And this essentially just hides the home screen from popping up when you open After Effects. All the other settings I leave on default, and those are just the main ones that I would change. Next, let's go into the Previews tab. In the Previews tab, I usually change Adaptive Resolution to 1/16, or depending on your own device, however low it can go. This allows you to play back larger files quicker. Under Viewer Quality, what I would do is change the zoom quality to more accurate if it's not already selected, and be sure that the color management quality is more accurate except cached preview. What this does is in the composition window, if you zoom in quite a bit, it'll preserve the accuracy of the pixels. And one thing you definitely want to make sure that's unchecked is audio, mute audio when preview is not in real time. If you've ever tried to play audio back, you know, inside After Effects and
it slows down because it can't render in real time,
this is how you stop that. And then the last option here is to cache frames while idle. If you don't notice, if you ever animate something or do something inside After Effects, it will actually render out the frames around your playhead. So here are a few of the settings you can adjust. You can adjust the length of time. So for example, you can change this to 15 seconds if you want a longer period of time. The max is 15, but I usually just leave it on 8. And then usually cache frames around current time is good for me. And then obviously cache range to work area, because why would you want to cache your frames outside of your work area if you're not working in it? Now, one funny thing about this menu is there isn't really a way to disable this. But fortunately for you, I found a way that you can actually disable this by using a secret menu.
Wow.
To get to the secret menu, click OK, and then go back into Preferences. Under Previews, hold down Shift and click. Then you'll notice on the left side, there's actually a secret tab. And if you click on the secret tab, you can click on the button next to disable layer cache. And this will actually disable that feature. I don't know why Adobe calls this a secret, but I guess it's not a secret anymore. Okay, so next let's go down to display. And for motion path, I usually leave it on default. This is where you can actually edit how you see the motion paths. When it comes to stuff like this, I like to edit my compositions on a one-to-one basis, depending on the composition I'm editing. If you want to actually customize your view options, what you can do actually inside the composition is click on the window and go up to View, View Options. And you can actually disable motion paths inside the composition you're working on. But if you do want to disable it, you can do it for the entire project inside Preferences. Otherwise, these other four options, I would leave the first two disabled and the second two checked. Next, let's go into the Import tab. Still footage I would leave on default, but if you work on image sequences, you can actually change your frames per second. So say if you wanted to change it to 24, or if you're working in a different frame rate, you can change it there. Now this is important. If you work with H.264 footage or H.265 footage, you'll want to make sure that you check the box next to Enable Hardware Acceleration Decoding. And what this does, it basically helps After Effects decode that type of footage faster. If you don't know, H.264 and H.265 codecs are harder for your computer to actually decode and process. So checking this box just helps it out a little bit better. Other than that, I would leave the rest on default. Next, let's go to output. To be honest, output doesn't really matter that much anymore. Back in the day, if After Effects was used to actually export DVD files, you'd want to segment your video and audio files. So this menu doesn't really matter anymore. Next, let's go into grids and guides. This is really up to personal preference, but the one note that I would just say is just make sure your grid and guide colors are really vibrant and stand out. You know, obviously you don't want darker colors. So I like, you know, neon green, and guides can leave at blue or maybe like a hot pink, very bright colors that stand out against your layers inside your composition panel. Now under grid line and subdivisions, I do recommend knocking down subdivisions a little bit. That way it's just a little bit easier to see if you enable them inside your composition panel. And just to show you, if I click OK and I go to grid, you'll notice that it's a little bit easier to see with these two subdivisions, where if it's set on 4, it's a little harder to see. For safe margins and guides, I would just leave this the way it is. Obviously, you can change the style to dash lines if you want. Like I said, this is up to personal preference. Next, let's go to labels. Same thing here. This is really up to you. You can change the label colors if you wish and actually change the names of the colors. Now, one note when actually working with this, by default, you'll notice that the text, null object, and solids are all set to red. And if you wanted to segment these a little bit better, you can actually change the default color. Because you will notice in my timeline here, if you have a lot of text, null objects, and solids, they do tend to blend in. Now, just note that you can actually just customize this by clicking and changing the color here. But if you want to set up by default, you can change the color and preferences. Next, let's go under media and disk cache, and this is a pretty important section. What I recommend doing is enabling the cache, and for the folder, I would recommend changing it to an internal drive, specifically an extra internal drive, but this might not always be the case. So if that's not the case, what I do recommend is maybe doing an external SSD hard drive. So what I would do is just navigate to an external hard drive, maybe make a new folder called cache, and then saving it in there, and then change the maximum disk cache to maybe 100 or so. But at the end of the day, just make sure wherever you save your cache, it has high speed. So a fast hard drive or a fast internal drive. That way you don't experience any lag while you're working inside After Effects. Same for conform media cache. Now, once you set up your caches here, what you'll notice is that you have an empty disk cache and then a clean database and cache button. You can click these buttons to delete some of your files. What clearing disk cache does, it basically removes any cache frames and effects. And what clearing the media database does, it basically deletes any stored import information needed to read and play back certain file types. So that's the difference between the two buttons. You can also access this outside of the preference settings. So say if we click OK, what you can do is go up to Edit, Purge. And you can actually do all memory and disk cache, or just all disk cache or image cache memory. So those are your options to clearing your cache and memory inside After Effects. To finish this off, what I would do is check the box next to write XMP IDs to files on import. This will just make it a little bit easier if you tend to share your files with other editors or designers. All right, next let's go to video preview. Now this doesn't really relate to me that much, but if you work with external monitors, this is where you can actually go and set this up. Now I will leave a link down in the video description if you do want to go and set that up for yourself. Next, let's go over to appearance. This is really up to personal preference. This is where you can, you know, make After Effects lighter if you want. If you like that type of thing, but I personally like leaving it dark. Now to keep this tutorial interesting, I'm going to show you something that most people don't know inside After Effects, and that's actually changing the theme color. So by default, you'll notice that the theme color, you know, the time code, the buttons and everything is set to blue. But what if you wanted to personalize it a little bit? You can do that by kind of hacking After Effects a little bit. What we're going to do is actually click OK and navigate to your composition panel. What you'll want to do is hit Command F12 or Control F12 if you're on a PC, and this will open up the console panel. Now in the hamburger menu, what you'll want to do is go to Debug Database View. Then in the search panel, type in color. You'll notice a few options here. What you can do is check the box next to Enable Theme Colorizing. And what this will do is if you go back into After Effects Preferences Appearance, you'll notice that there's a Change Color button now. You can click on that and actually make the theme color any color you wish. Pretty cool, right? All right, let's go into the next tab. So under New Project, this is where you can actually set up a template that you can load from when you create a new project inside After Effects. I tend to don't do this, but if you want to do it, you can click this button right here. You can actually choose your template file that you want to choose. Next, let's go into Autosave. And this is where you can actually set up autosave if you want After Effects to save your files once in a while. Just be sure that you check the box next to Save Every, and you can actually change this from 20 minutes. Say if you want it a little quicker, maybe every 5 minutes, you can change that to a lower value. And I do recommend checking the box next to save when starting render queue, because the worst thing that can happen is you send it to render and it crashes and you lose everything. And then I would change maximum project versions all the way up. They don't take that much file size, so you can, you know, get away with a large number here. And it's only saving every 5 minutes, so, you know, if you do the math, that's only 2400 times in a workday. You can set up a custom location, but I do just recommend just doing it next to the project. That way everything's really easy to find if you need to recover something. Next, let's go into memory and performance. Now, obviously I have a lower grade Mac here that only has 16 gigabytes of RAM, but I do recommend changing this to the lowest value possible, really depending on your own setup. That way it's dedicating as much RAM as possible to After Effects. Now, one of the newer features inside After Effects is the ability to actually set up what's called multi-frame rendering. And that's what's located underneath the RAM memory section. So you can check this box next to enable multi-frame rendering. And if you've seen other creators use this, this is the fancy green little line when you go to export your After Effects compositions. What this does is it allows After Effects to use your extra CPU data to help render your compositions out a little bit quicker, rendering more with them one frame at a time, hence the name. So that's multi-frame rendering. It really depends. This might not show up depending on your own hardware and CPU settings. If you want to learn more, there's a link down in the video description if you want to see how your CPU stacks up if you enable this setting. Next, let's go to audio hardware. This is where you can change your audio hardware, but I honestly recommend if you are playing audio back in After Effects that you actually change it in your system preferences. If you change your audio and system preferences, it'll actually automatically update it inside After Effects. This also works with Premiere Pro as well. So we're gonna skip audio hardware and audio output mapping for now. Next, let's go into sync settings. To be honest, I usually leave these on default, but if you work with teams a lot, you might want to make some changes. And just to show you if you need to sync your settings, you can always click this little icon in the top right. You can sync now, and you'll be able to sync your settings. Next, let's go into the type menu. The really only significant thing in here is this is where you can change the font preview size. So if you need it larger, you can actually increase it. You'll notice that when you go into the character panel, everything's a lot larger for you. But I tend to just leave it on small, but that's really a personal preference. Next, let's go into scripting and expressions. A few things I change in here. I usually check this box next to allow scripts to write files and access network. A lot of these I leave on default, but one thing I do uncheck is autocomplete. Usually when I'm manually typing in an expression, I'm trying to type in an expression and After Effects sometimes wants to auto fill it in where I want to go in a different direction. So it really depends how you write expressions, but I usually uncheck it. Next, under 3D, the only thing really to note is I usually just leave these on default, but you can also change how the mouse or scroll wheel behaves. So this is helpful if you want to go in a different direction or use a different tool. Other than that, the last section is notifications. This is actually a relatively new feature. This is helpful if you have multiple devices. It'll actually push notifications when you actually add something to the render queue. And you can also notify your different devices once a render is complete. And to show you how that works, I'm just going to click the box, click OK, and you can push something to the render queue. And you'll notice that there's a little notify checkbox under notify here. This will notify you once the render is complete. So that's After Effects preferences that I use all the time. If you want to learn more about After Effects, here's a video that I think you might like right up there. Otherwise, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.